Tell us about some of the hobbies of persons, because I heard you mention Elmer Jordan, and he is also a proud son of the soil and a former resident of St. Peter. He's deceased now. He had a supermarket by the name of
Elmer's,
Elmer's, right? That is in the that occupies that is being occupied now by Jordan's supermarket.
No, it was across the road where the town hall mall is, the town hall square. It was across the road, and then Jordan's moved across. But that's the reason why my father and my uncle went out of business. Back in the day, you would trust. And my uncle was the big wig out of all the brothers. And they would take their provisions from General Traders on Robert Street. And in the early 60s, the supermarkets came in. Supermarkets don't trust, right? But my uncle ended up in a lot of debt. And that's how the whole Atherley dynasty started to go down. General Traders actually took over my uncle's shop because he owed them that much money, the shop and the bakery. But I remember the days because I attended Spikestown Boys School. Started at a private school in Midland Quarter called Miss Jilt School. But then we shifted my oldest brother of the three of us. There are others outside, so they're all brothers. My oldest brother at home, he went to Court and Parry. And my second brother and I, we went to Spikestown Boys. So I would fish on the wharf after school.
Pond boating.
Pond boating, yes, that used to happen. Mr. Jordan, Elmer Jordan, was really a fan of pond boating. And the pond boats would race between the wharf behind the fish market and the Manning's wharf, the Challoner wharf as it was then. It wasn't Manning Wilkinson and Challoner, yeah, it was Challoner. And they would race between there. There was a salt pond which ran from the Wing Gully, as it is nowadays, it's canalized, but you remember the floods of 1984. And that ran behind there, it was not canalized yet. And it ran behind my uncle's business and ran out into the sea next to the sand shop, which is presently Fisherman's Pub. It was known as the sand shop back then, before Clement Armstrong took it over from his father. Right, so I remember my days at school. We had three delivery vans and they were kept at my house in Midland Quarter, the house in which I presently live. And the drivers would come there early in the morning and drive to Spikestown to the bakery, because they delivered to the hotels on the coast, on the west coast. Back then you would have had Paradise Beach, Sandy Lane, Miramar, which is now Fairmont Royal Pavilion, Colony Club, and Coral Reef. Those were the main hotels on the coast back then. And my uncle provided them all with bread and groceries back then in the 60s, 50s, 60s. Yeah, so it was quite a big business. But it's gone the way of, right.
And I heard you mention another key St. Peter place name, the Rim. And of course, Sybil Leacock would have also been from the Rim. And I heard you mention a private school, Miss Jilks.
Yes.
Miss Jilks'
Well,
private school is.
yeah, Miss Jilt's private school. It was owned by
And
an Ada Jilt's, and she had her sister, Miss Winnie. You know, back then we were the children, black bourgeoisie, and we attended piano lessons and so. And as when I was teaching at Curzon Parry, they would always tease me and say that they went to school barefoot, but I never knew that I never went to school barefoot, which is true, right? But we were quite well off, I would say. And I realized that because, you know, I was called Master Aird and Master Jeffrey and Master Newland by the people in the district. You know, but things have changed quite a lot. The whole country has become more democratized and people have climbed the social ladder. So there's not now that class distinction that you had back then. But Miss Jilts had a private school and we attended there. And then I changed over to Spikestown Boys in about 1960. Attended that for 3 years. Quite interesting. Mr. Halley Marville was the headmaster. Banfield McLean, the musician, he was the deputy. And when Mr. Marville retired, Mr. McLean took over. And Mr. McLean was an excellent musician.
And
And
he was also from
he was
the
also
parish.
from Chapel Road, Chapel Street in Spikestown. The family still lives there. And I remember fishing on the wharf. I remember, but that was when I went to secondary school. When I went to secondary school, the Parson College, the bus stand was in the road by James Griffith's shop. Mm-hmm. This is the road that passes across into Sand Street,
right.
Orange Street. You come from Queen Street to Orange Street. And when you pass Major Walk on the right where the resource center is, if you continue further northwards, that's Sand Street. But the buses, there was a big old bond house in the road, and the buses would park there. I remember the M3876, the stud, used to be driven by Tarzan and Ox. Those back then, only two people would share one transport board bus. So you could monitor who mashed up the bus,
wow.
Right? And they would park in the road. We would gather there in the bus stand. There was a little baker shop as you moved into Major Walk. Payne's Baker Shop. It was small, but did some good bread, like my uncle's own.
Okay.
They were known for their turnovers. My uncle was known for his machine loads.
Okay.
Right? And people like Peggy McGeary and so, who were, they were slightly older than me, but I remember also the pickups, mm-hmm. Benji's pickup and Sunny Lou pickup. And sometimes there was an experiment carried out for about two terms. We're at Harrison College back in 65 or 66. They started quite early. They started an hour earlier than usual. So I would have to catch the Indian Ground bus or Benji's pickup or Sunny, no, not Sunny Lou. Sunny Lou was a slow driver.
Mm-hmm.
And he had painted on the pickup, "Why worry? Safety first." He had told the painter to write, "Why hurry?" But the painter did not understand it should be, so "Why hurry?" So he put, "Why worry?" And, right. But school days were wonderful, commuting from Mullen Quarter to Bridgetown, the Lower Green, having to walk up the back alleys behind to where the Sanitation Service Authority was, which is now the Central Bay. Walk up to Amen Alley next to Green Lake School, up to Harrison College. At the time, there were only about six of us at the very most from the north of the island attending Harrison College. Six people from the north, six boys. It was about 400 at the school. And just about a quarter of us were black.
Wow.
So it taught me a lot.
So I was going to ask, how did the color, not so much class, but color distinction, your school life? And did that too inspire you to become an educator in turn? I mean, your school days, because you described some very...
Mm-hmm.
very
honestly, I never
very good school
intended
days.
To become an educator, you know? When you're a boy, you want to be a pilot,
okay. Uh-huh.
Or a doctor or something. But I would say it was Mr. Herman Botzel, who was my French teacher, who in 1969 took us to Martinique. We stayed at the Lycée Chalchère, which was the top boys' school back then in Martinique. And the Queen's College, we were in the dormitory downstairs. The Queen's College girls were in the dormitory upstairs. And I remember that well. And then it was after coming back to, I got a grade one in French and in Spanish. And
that's
I barely passed maths.
Okay.
And I said, I don't think I should follow science if I'm not good at maths.
Mm-hmm.
So then I went into modern six, lower six, modern six and
right.
upper.
Mm-hmm.
Ahead of me were people like Adonijah, my cousin, and Blanchett, Victor Blanchett, and these people. He was a miler at the time.
Right, also yeah. from?
No, they were from, okay. There was only, in 1963, three of us from Spikes and Boys School passed through Harrison College.
Okay.
And I think there were another two or so from All Saints.
Mm-hmm.
But as I told you, there were just a few of us from the north, just
okay.
including St. James. There must have been a dozen of us who went to college in 63. I finished in 71, 8 years. At the time, there was a lower first. Right, so we did lower first, second, third. So it took 6 years to get up to sixth form and out, to get up to fifth form and out, and then another 2 years.
Okay.
And I was also a cadet at the time. So I remember well cadet camp at the garrison. I remember going to Jamaica when the Canadians used to finance the cadet camps. I remember going to New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, Gagetown, Army Camp, Prince Edward Island. The only time I've ever visited was as a cadet back in 71. I left school in 71.
Well, I must say that you're very, very well-traveled and very well-versed in your parish.
I must point out, though, I'm a tour guide, but I'm not a historian. I'm a linguist.
Could have fooled
us. I'm a linguist. No, I'm a linguist, right?
Yeah.
I I've done linguistics, Caribbean dialectology, and these sort of things, and along with French and English. And I taught English. Well, when I left school the June, and I did the induction course during the long vacation. And at age 18 years, 7 months, I was teaching fifth formers at Aird. And
Wow, that is
I was
impressive.
just a year or a few, in some cases, just 9 months older than them.
Wow.
It was quite an experience.
So how did they react to you?
Well, first of all, I suffered a sort of a cultural shock coming from Harrison College, where it was quite disciplined. I'm not trying to suggest or imply that Aird wasn't quite disciplined, but you had led a sort of a cloistered life at Harrison College. And then you go to teach at Aird. Mr. Baffert, Cuthbert Baffert, was the principal. He had some military discipline at that school, right? He really had it.